I will try to present some ideas on the importance of Jan Crinoy into the context of the European organ building of this time and the connection of Flemish organ builders with Spain. Let us remember that between 1516 and 1556, both Spain and the Low Countries were under the same governor, the King Charles I, Emperor of the Holy Roman Empire. Charles was born in Ghent, in the Netherlands. He was the son of Juana la Loca and Philip de Hanson, Duke of Burgundy, and the son of Emperor Maximilian of Austria. Charles was, therefore, grandson of Emperor Maximilian. As is well known, due to the different political and religious conflicts that arose during that time into the immense territory under his jurisdiction, Emperor Charles divides his residence between Spain, Italy, Austria, Germany, and above all, the Netherlands. Not in vain, the administrative center of this kingdom was located in Brussels, where Queen Mary of Hungary acted as a regent. During his absences from Spain, Charles' wife, Isabel of Portugal, served also as a regent there. After her death in 1539, the regency will pass to Prince Philip, the future king, Philip II. In 1548, Prince Philip embarks on a journey through Spain, Italy, Austria, and Germany to meet his father, Emperor Charles, in Brussels. The purpose of this trip was to present the prince as heir and successor to the throne in the 17 provinces of the Netherlands. The interesting point for us in this story is that Prince Philip's chamber musician Antonio de Cabezón was a part of the entourage during those travels. I think it is not necessary to talk here about the importance of Antonio de Cabezón in the panorama of European keyboard music of the 16th century. Not only because of the quantity and variety of music that has come down to us from him, much more than from any other keyboard composer from that time, but also the figure of Cabezón is also of great importance due to the amount of information that has come down to us about his composition and interpretation techniques, especially through the treatise of Fray Tomás de Santa María, which included one of the first systematic compendiums of instructions on keyboard technique, fingering, ornamentation, inégalité, as well as improvisation and composition. Thanks to his travels with Prince Philip, Antonio de Cabezón was able to come into contact with an enormous number of musicians and artists of all genres, origins and conditions. And conversely, his music could be heard and appreciated by an immense audience. First in Spain, in all the cities where he resided with the court, then itinerant, but also in Italy, Austria, Germany, the Netherlands, and England, always accompanying Prince Philip in his journeys. It is important to remark that in total, Antonio de Cabezón spent 4 years and 5 months of his life outside of Spain. Of all the places that he visited, 3 deserve to be highlighted. Augsburg, where he spent 10 months, London, and other royal residences of Queen Mary Tudor, where he resided for about a year, and especially the Low Countries, where he spent a total of about 15 months, of which he lives in Brussels for more than 11. However, we must not forget that the life of Antonio de Cabezón runs in parallel to that of his brother Juan, also an organist in the service of the Spanish crown. Juan de Cabezón also traveled as a member of the Chapel of the Prince, but his stay in the Netherlands lasted 3 more years, so in total more than 7 years in these regions, until the return of the King Philip to Spain in 1559. Taking into account that Antonio was blind, Juan should be considered as a potential transmitter of visual information to his father. The panorama that we try to present here can lead us to numerous reflections on the possible relationships, the possible influences exerted and received by the Cabezón brothers throughout those years. But now we have to focus our attention on a specific aspect, that one of the instruments. Few musicians of their time, like the Cabezón brothers, were able to have such an extensive knowledge of the different construction schools of keyboard instruments, and especially of organ building on the European context. We should consider not only the multitude of instruments that they have seen, touched, heard, and played in Spain, that is to say, Castilian instruments of medieval tradition, large Gothic organs built by German organ builders in the 15th century in Spain, with two and even three manuals, instruments built by the first generation of Flemish organ builders in Catalonia, with overladder and root positive. We need to take in account also the organs of separate stops visited in Italy, the Transalpine instruments made by German organ builders, the instruments of South Germany, plus the organs of both the North and South tradition in the Netherlands. From instruments based on separate stops on a single manual, to instruments with several keyboards and pedals. From instruments based on a block bag, to modern instruments with different stops of principal flutes and reeds. From small portatives to large 16 and 24 feet cathedral organs. From instruments with 38 keys on the keyboard, to big instruments with country octaves that reaches 54 keys or more. Analyzing the itinerary of the Cabezón brothers and those travelings, we can be sure that they were in contact somehow with the instruments built by organ builders of first level from very different schools and traditions. From Italy, so you can, the Antegnati, Facchetti, they're the builders of the organ of the places that we know that the Chapel of the Prince was visited the places, sometimes for several days or even weeks, so we can be more sure that they have an approach to Losestan. Also, Italy and also Austria and South Germany, South Netherlands, and also the North. After exposing this world panorama, let's go to the question that brings us to Lorraine today. In the spring of 1561, Philip II, the Queen, took the decision to make Madrid the capital of the Kingdom of Spain. In fact, Madrid will become the capital of the enormous empire under his jurisdiction. That included the Netherlands, several territories in Italy, as well as in America and Philippines. At that moment, a series of actions begin to provide the city with the necessary elements to achieve that goal. Madrid is then adorned with palaces, churches, monasteries, squares, and gardens, following European models. Evidently, among the essential elements to be provided were the organs, those to have to serve in the Royal Chapel in Madrid, and those to use in the rest of the religious institution of the city. From the documentation extracted and published by Professor Cristina Bordas in 1992, we know that it was precisely Antonio de Cabezón who recommended, in 1561, to acquire two organs for the use of the Royal Chapel in the Netherlands. The interesting point is that, considering all the instruments that Antonio de Cabezón would have seen, considering he was blind, seen now, heard, touched, and played in Spain, Italy, Austria, Germany, England, and the Netherlands, he suggested and designed specifically Jean Crinon, organ builder of the town of Mons, for this project. Why Jean Crinon? It is not easy to answer this question, but the truth is that Cabezón's first contact with the organs in the Netherlands occurs as soon as he arrived in Brussels on the 2nd of April 1549. That day, Prince Philip was received and sang Gudule in Brussels with grace, softness, and voices and organ. Precisely, the organ at San Gudule has been built by Crinon only a few years earlier. Later, on the 31 of July, the Prince Interrage visited the Abbaye Saint-Bertrand in Saint-Omer, where they enter in procession. The next day, they attended the Mass in the Saint Temple. There, Grineau had built an organ 4 years earlier. On the 2nd of August, the next day, a Mass was celebrated for the Prince in the Church of Notre-Dame in Saint-Omer, where Grineau had just finished the organ 2 years earlier. Curiously, this instrument in the Church of Notre-Dame in Saint-Omer is the only one organ to which the account of that trip, written by the chronicler Juan Cristóbal Calvete de la Estrella, is specifically refers in these terms. Then, the next day, which was the 2nd of August, the prince went out to the Mass at the Church of Saint-Omer, where there is a lot to see, because it's a great building, as well as because of the great wealth and ornaments it has, with many relics, and the best organ that exists in these territories. It is evident that the quality and beauty of the instrument built by Grineau in Saint-Omer will not only attract the attention of the chronicler, but also of the organist Antonio and Juan de Cabezón. Taking into account Grineau's activity in the area, it is more than likely that Antonio and Juan de Cabezón would have been able to maintain a professional and personal relationship with Jean Grineau during the time of their stay in the Netherlands. In any case, it can be assumed that Cabezón's choice demonstrates a preference for the style of construction and the phonic result of Grineau's instruments over many other possible options that in fact he knew. It is also interesting to reflect on that. The instrument at the Church of Notre Dame in Saint-Omer, that caught attention of the Prince Interrage in 1549, could be the same on which Jean Titelouze would open his eyes and ears to music only a few years later. Then the development of organ building in France under the influence of Titelouze would therefore be reflected in the development of organ building in Spain under the influence of Cabezón. But let's return to the strictly historical story. From the documentation published by Cristina Bordas, we know that in 1561, Michel Bock, Flemish organist in the Spanish Royal Chapel in Madrid, traveled to the Netherlands and met personally with Grineau in Mons, as Antonio de Cabezón had suggested an order. But Grineau refused to take share of the work, apologizing pour les grands ouvrages qu'il avait entre mains, because he has other big works to build at the moment. Then the organist Michel Bock went to Antwerp on the advice of Cardinal Granvelle. There he would meet Gilles Brebos, who accepted to build the two organs for the Royal Chapel, and those organs were delivered and sent to Madrid in record time. From here on, the story is well known. Gilles Brebos and his 4 sons will travel to Spain, taking charge of one of the most ambitious projects in the history of European organ building, the construction of the 4 large organs for the monastery of El Escorial, as well as several instruments for other institutions connected with the Royal Chapel in Madrid. I think there is a photo here. Yeah. Of the cases of Brebos at the Escorial, the big organs, 2 symmetrical organs, and the choir organ. At least from that instrument, the pipes of the front could be perhaps distinctly by him. Immediately, after other organ builders joined the Brebos team in Madrid, not only Spanish ones, but also from foreign countries, as for example, Orazio Fabri from Naples, or the Flemish Mati Languedul, making then the team real an international team. The arrival of foreign organ builders didn't happen only in Madrid at the moment. It is significant that this precise historical moment around the death of Antonio de Cabezón in 1566 marks the beginning of a period of settlement of Flemish and French organ builders in different areas of Spain, which adds to the initial settlement of Peter Flamenge in Barcelona in 1538. This is a list of the more or less the Flemish and North French organ builders coming to Spain with the date they arrived and the places where they settled. Thus, apart from the focus in Catalonia, the center of Madrid around the Royal Chapel, Zaragoza, and in the south, Seville and Granada, will be dominated by the presence of Flemish organ builders during more than one century. An interesting fact is that all those centers of activity of the Flemish organ builders in Spain were supported and promoted by the most prominent organists at the moment. No doubt, those organists prefer the modern orientation of those masters to the more traditional style of construction of the Hispanic organ builders. Thus, Hernando de Cabezón, Palero, Aguilera de Heredia, Bruna, or Francisco Correa de Rauxo were in direct contact with the work of the Flemish and French organ builders settled in their centers of activities. In such a way that their Flemish instruments in their churches acted both as a source of inspiration and the recipients of the music that they created, a music that made us to enjoy so much even today. Regarding this aspect, it is essential to notice that several of those Flemish organ builders were involved in the invention and development of the split stop in Spain. In any case, it's also important to highlight that the export of the Flemish organ tradition and techniques through those masters didn't end it in the Iberian Peninsula. The preserved documentation demonstrates that especially the workshop of Enrique Franco in Seville were building instruments to be exported to the American territories, especially to Mexico and Peru. So, when evaluating this entire historical context, it must be recognized that in the period 1565 to 1650, more or less, the technique and aesthetic of Flemish organ building had spread from its origin to the entire Iberian Peninsula, to America, and surely even to the Philippines, so reaching the limits of the Spanish Empire. The amount of organological vestiges of the Flemish tradition still existing from this period in Spain and America were worth a cataloging and a study effort. Those vestiges complement the enormous amount of documentation extracted from Spanish archives, especially by researchers like Antonio Ramírez Palacios during more than 40 years. Unfortunately, the research of that man ended when he died 5 years ago, and all the documentation is waiting to be published. To finish, I would like to point out that the Flemish legacy into the Spanish world also concerns interpretative questions. The registration charts written in 1586 by Jost Schwitzen for the organ he built in the Cathedral of Sevilla, and those drawn up for the four Brevos organ at the Escorial Monastery around 1590, undoubtedly present some musical practices also imported from the Netherlands to Spain. Significantly, both registration charts contain the first instructions for the registration of the basso trompet, before we can find them in the Libre Fratum, as well as for various types of receipts. But in the case of the Escorial, they also transmit the instruction for playing the dialogue using reed stops and change of manual, exactly as requested by French sources some decades later. Those charts also refer to the registration of the pieces in echo, so popular in the Spanish environment. For me, it is surprising that those sources are normally neglected when discussing the interpretation of those European repertories. The connection between Spain and Flemish practices is reinforced by the fact that the possible drafter or inspirer of this instruction for registration was the organist Charles de Lille, who professed as a monk in El Escorial in 1587. We know that his name was Charles de Sponchot, and he was the son of the organist at the Church of Saint-Pierre in Lille, with whom he had learned to play the organ. When Charles de Lille died in 1631, the sepulchral memories of the monastery of El Escorial will refer to him in this way. He served this monastery playing the organs. He did it so well that it seems like those organs were made especially for him. In my opinion, this testimony shows that Charles de Lille knew perfectly not only the characteristic element of Flemish organ building, but also the precise way of playing the music composed for them. Then at that point, organ playing and organ building meet in a perfect way, exactly as the mastery of Antonio de Capefon had found its proper and perfect vehicle of expression through the organs built by Jean Crinon. Thank you.